Hello everyone, I'm Sujatha Hemmady. I currently work at Redbus. Since 2 years, I'm an Erlang developer. So today, I'll be talking about my journey with Erlang at Redbus. More than my journey, I believe it's every developer's journey who is trying to move from object-oriented language to Erlang. So along with the journey, I'll try also explaining some of the core concepts of Erlang so that it becomes clear. So to start with, I started my career as a Java developer. I was trained in Java for 3 months. Overall, I have 4 years of experience in Java. With the help of a great team, each day was a new learning, so I quickly understood Java. So with my curiosity, I dig deeper into the language and I tried understanding how actually the language works rather than how to make things work with the language. With all this learning, I was in a mindset thinking that Java is the solution for all given problems. Then Erlang was introduced to me. Erlang was introduced to me by Neeraj Sharma at Redbus. So for people who do not know what we do at Redbus, Redbus is basically a bus ticket booking platform. I'll give more details later on, but for now, let's consider two systems. One is transaction system, and other is accounting and invoicing system. Transaction system is a backend for bus ticket booking, which takes care of the life cycle of entire bus booking. And accounting and invoicing system is a system which automates the accounting and invoicing part of the Redbus transaction. Basically, it calculates how the money should flow for each of the transactions. I used to work in accounting and invoicing system, which was written in Java. It was challenging in its own way, but I had reached a point where all my mind could process was numbers, incomes, expenses, etc. I knew I needed a change. And at the same time, in Redbus, the decision was taken to write transaction system in Erlang. Why this decision was taken is not very sure to me, but I needed a change. That is the reason I felt learning Erlang was the change required for me to move to transaction system without any knowledge of what this language does or how this language behaves. The sole purpose of me taking up the decision to learn Erlang was for me to move to the transaction system. That's how I saw it as, without any clue of how the language works. That's why I call it as a forced choice Erlang. Before going on to the technical road of the journey, there's something I need to address regarding the psychological factors which impact the journey. This has a major impact. Let's talk about it. That is resistance to accept change. Why does this happen? It can happen due to multiple reasons. Maybe it depends on person to person. But according to my experience and few of my colleagues' experience, all I can say is the major villain is comfort zone. Coming out of comfort zone is never easy. In my case, knowing Erlang and being able to, being comfortable working in Java was that comfort zone, which I was not ready to let go of. That was the main hindrance for me. Other reason could be when you are not sure why this change is happening. As I said earlier, that I took up a decision to learn Erlang because I wanted to move to a different system altogether. That was the decision taken by me. But with respect to learning a language, that is not the right kind of motivation to start with. This is the main demotivating factor for me while learning the Erlang. Few other things are like fear of unknown. Questions like, what if I do not like Erlang? What if I start forgetting Java? Or is it the right choice for my career? Or will I be an expert in any particular language if I take up this decision? All these kind of questions had popped up in my mind. But with my experience, all I can say is, no, you will not forget Java. But learning Erlang from Java is a little difficult because of the object-oriented mindset. But over a period of time, you will accept a language. Actually, you'll start liking the language. One thing benefited is for me here is learning Erlang broadened my perspective of solutioning the problem. That's a good thing about Erlang. So while I was researching on this topic, I found this diagram. Actually, it depicts more or less every developer's mindset who tries to learn Erlang from object-oriented language. So if not 100%, 90% of them start in the denial mode. Even today, if you see two developers talking with two developers with the different language background speaking, they'll get into an argument mode where they will try to prove each other saying that this language is better without even having a mindset to accept that maybe there's something better in the other language. In my case, this conversation happened with the Golang developer. Both being a concurrency language, you can imagine how the argument can go on with. Okay, next state would be confusion and anger. This confusion and anger is a part and parcel of the denial mode. Denial mode, me being not able to let go of Java. In that mindset, me trying to understand Erlang leads into a lot of confusion. End up being angry on yourself for taking up a decision to learn Erlang. So most of them tend to quit in this phase where because of confusion and anger for the decision taken to learn Erlang, you tend to give up. But I survived this phase by asking two questions to myself. Either get a solid reason to quit or try finding a reason why you need to accept the language. Here I am talking about my journey with Erlang, so you know what question I found the answer to. So whoever are stuck, please try finding this answer. Either answer you get, you are sorted with the journey. So give you 100% before you quit. To give an overview of both the language, since I have background with both the language, let's start with Java. Java is an object-oriented language where its main building blocks are objects. Where real-world entities are represented as an object. For example, let's take this conference as an example. Here, conference hall will be an object which encapsulates all you individuals as a set of person object. And me being another person object with special property as a presenter. This is how object model will look like for a conference hall. So once the session is done, I may leave the room. Some of you might leave or somebody can join. All these changes are represented in Java world by modifying the existing conference hall. And this modifying the existing conference hall is called mutability. So in object-oriented language, they use mutability as the main construct. And this mutability is achieved by having shared heap memory, where in Java, every object created are put into the shared heap memory, where n number of threads with the right access can modify them. So JVM is a Java virtual machine, a runtime execution unit for Java. Coming to Erlang, Erlang is a functional and concurrency-oriented language. Its main building blocks are process, not to confuse with OS process, but it's a lightweight process created and maintained by Beam. I'll explain this further later on, but for now, it's a process created and maintained by Beam. Beam being the execution unit for Erlang. And this language, okay, taking back the example of conference hall, in Erlang world, this would be represented as conference hall will be a supervisor where each of us will be a process created under that supervisor. And me delivering this speech would be like a message passing from me as a person process to each one of you. Since we don't share a memory, these messages are copied onto your brain. That copying is called immutability, where a message is not mutated. Each one gets its own copy, right? So this language works with immutability as the main construct. Since it's an immutable language, you don't need a shared heap memory. So each process gets its own private heap. Key difference what you need to understand here is in Java, concurrency is achieved by thread class, which is an abstraction of native threads. Since there is a shared memory involved, you will have to have synchronization or some locking mechanism to have a safer concurrency. But in Erlang, concurrency is handled by Beam, detaching that concurrency model from the OS layer. So to give an overview of Redbus, Redbus basically is India's largest bus ticket booking platform, founded in 2006. As of today, we have served 8 million customers. We are not just in India, we are operational in Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Colombia, and Peru. As a Redbus platform, we even have services like bus hire, hotels, pilgrimages, and Arpool. Arpool being the newest service of Redbus, which enables bike pooling and car pooling for the office commuters. If you see, the bottom most part of the slide shows the search bar where you have to enter your source location, destination location, and the date of journey when you have to travel. And hit a search button, you will get all the set of buses in that route for a given day. Even this search result is powered by Erlang, different Erlang platform, which is rewritten in Erlang a year back. I'm not going to talk about this because I have not worked with this, but in Redbus, we do use Erlang for search result. So the middle part of the slide where you can see the seat layout, where you select a seat, enter your boarding point, dropping point, and your customer, basically your details, and try to book the ticket. That's when the transaction system comes into picture. The life cycle of booking the ticket is handled by transaction system. Basically, right from creating tentative block, payments, and confirmation, all happens in transaction system. That's where I have worked on, and even this has been written in Erlang from last 2 years. So next few slides, I'll be talking about few of the constructs in Erlang which are easy to understand but hard to adapt to. So one being the syntax. Syntax, every language, it differs. But this syntax is so different than Java, it is a little hard to understand. So as learning any language, easiest way to learn any language, even I started learning with syntax. As an added advantage, Erlang provides you with the shell where you can start with all the basic operations like summing up number, even try printing the hello world, or any syntax for that matter, which is shown in the right side of the slide, can be tried and tested only with the shell, not even bothering to create a module, compile it, and run. So that's the best part in Java, where you have a shell and try out different things, how Erlang behaves. But the question is this the right way to start learning the language? It's a yes and no answer, I agree, but for me, it's a yes. So it's better to start learning a language with syntax. Is it the only way to start learning the language? Not necessarily, actually. You can even start understanding the Erlang concepts first before you even try on the syntax. But being from the object-oriented mindset, it is a little hard to understand the concepts in Erlang. So whenever you try to understand a concept in Erlang, you always tend to say that, oh, this can be done in Java as well. What is so special in Erlang? But that mindset will have that problem that you will not be able to accept those concepts. So it's better to start with the syntax. This is something which is very simple to understand, but very hard to adapt to. That is mutability versus immutability. Mutability in simple terms being, once created can be modified n number of times, and immutability cannot be modified once created. Simple enough to understand. But once you start writing an Erlang, being that in Java, we always try to modify the object. Once you create, you keep modifying that object n number of times. But in Erlang, you cannot do that. That will create problem while writing the Erlang code. Even though you understand that Erlang will not support mutability, you will tend to write a mutable code in Erlang. That's the first thing. At least for a month or 2 months, you will end up creating a variable, modifying it, and assigning back it to the variable. Worst part is, it's not even a compile time error. So you run it, and then it fails. So you will have to get used to it for a while to adapt to this immutability. As I said, it is easy to understand this concept, but hard to adapt to. So it will take some time to reach that place of where you can create a variable, and if there's any change, recreate it and use it. One thing I found easier is that in immutable language, it's easier to debug. Why I see this is that any given program behaves differently when there is a corrupt data. That corruption of data in immutable language, where the data is created, is the only place where anything could go wrong. So you know the exact place where you need to check and identify the bug. But in mutable languages, when a single object is mutated from different places, you need to check each and every place to find which code might have corrupted the data. So it is little tedious in mutable. But since people are used to doing it in Java world, they don't find it as a problem. But once you move to a immutable language, you will see the benefit of immutability by debugging. Next thing is precaution is better than cure versus let it crash attitude. So I hope it's understood that precaution is better than cure represents Java and let it crash is for Erlang. In Java, we usually tend to write a defensive code, defensive programming, where a normal execution of a code is layered with multiple layers of errors. Basically, right from the null pointer exception till the IO exception, checked, unchecked, every possible exceptions, you try to handle it beforehand, correct? Even if you're using certain external resources like files, socket, you need to close even if there is an exception. All this cleanup has to be done in a Java program. But when Erlang says let it crash, does it even make sense in first place for Java developers at least? So whenever we try to write a program, we tend to say that it shouldn't have any problem once gone to production, right? So you tend to say that normal execution also should work and any of the unexpected behavior should also be handled. Usually we do that in Java. But in that mindset, if you say let it crash, what do you understand? So it is little hard to get into that practice of let it crash. Does that even mean saying that write the happy path and do not even bother about doing anything? Actually, it's not that way. You are supposed to handle all the validations, data validation, null check validation, all that you need to do in Erlang as well. Because you can't end up just giving some random error to user. You need to handle all those errors. It's not actually an error. It's a proper validation as per the business, correct? But there's something which you need not worry about, cleaning up the resources. Like in Erlang, each user request are a process. So this process, as I said earlier, has a private heap space, right? So any resources needed to run this process is within the process itself. So if the process dies, it will clean up everything by itself. So if a file is opened or socket is opened, it's all part of a process. When a process dies, it cleans up. So Erlang, you need not worry about cleaning up those kind of resources. That's one advantage I see in Erlang. But more than that, why does Erlang say let it crash? That's also because of the supervision tree. Erlang provides you with a supervision tree. What does it even mean? Application is started. Main guy who starts the application is a supervisor. Under the supervisor, each of the processes started. The supervisor's job is to handle the process state. Basically, if anything happens to a process, you define beforehand saying what needs to be done. So there are multiple strategies to handle these cases, like one to one, one to many. Like if there are n number of processes under a supervisor and you say one to many, if any of the process fail, it will restart all of the process. So all this are part and parcel of the Erlang's beam. You don't have to do anything. It comes as a package. This is one of the best thing in Erlang. It's also, you can say it's as a self-healing property of Erlang. Few other concepts are like, there are no loops in Erlang. Basically, no for, no do, do while, no while. This is scary enough because in Java, we always need for loop. Simplest of simplest problem, you would write a for loop, right? That is not there in Erlang. So to change from that mindset of no loop to having a recursion for every list is little hard. As I said, it's easy to understand, but you can't adapt to it. That's one change required when you move to Erlang. No inheritance, no overloading. But overloading, I correlated it with the pattern matching in the functions. So in that sense, it made little sense to me. So, okay, how I started seeing the better side of the language. By now, actually, it's been a year. I was struggling with all this, and then we were already live in production like 1 year back. I mean, 2 years back, we were live. But, okay, sorry. The thing is, we were live. So I have seen the matrices where we had no major production bugs. There were no unexpected bugs in the production. So, and there's no CPU hike, no stop the world GC. So it all went smooth. So I knew there's a benefit in Erlang, but I couldn't sense it because I did not know actually how the Erlang works. So I could see the benefits, but to get that into my sense, like I was not able to accept because I was not very sure of how Erlang was used to work. That's when I started finding the answers of how and why this language works this way. So it almost took 1 year to get here. So this was the first thing I answered for myself. Whenever people talk about Erlang, Erlang means soft real time. So finding answer to what is soft real time was very important. Because when I started the language, I had no clue what soft real time meant. So this is something very important to me because by finding the answer to the soft real time, I found my confidence with the language. I actually started feeling that I know Erlang. Rather than saying that I know to work in Erlang, I started feeling I actually know Erlang. So let's try understanding this. Okay, what is soft real time? Basically, systems under certain circumstances can tolerate certain amount of delay. These delays are acceptable but not desirable. Let me repeat. Systems under certain circumstances can tolerate certain amount of delay, and these delays are acceptable but not desirable. Let's take an example for as ticket booking experience during the offer season, okay? Where given a choice, is it okay to fail few bookings or is it better we serve everybody with a little delay? Obviously, the answer would be is that the little delay is okay rather than failing the few of the bookings, right? So that serving everybody with little delay during the unexpected load is the behavior of soft real time. To coming back to the definition, if you see systems under certain circumstances, meaning ticket booking experience during the offer period where it's an unexpected load there, and we serving all of them with little delay is tolerable because people are getting bus tickets at least. Even with the delay, people are happy that they are getting a bus ticket. So it's acceptable because people are getting the bus ticket. It's not desirable because there might be some irritation due to the slowness. That's why we call it as, that's why we say it's a best effort system. It will try its best to serve everybody equally, even at an unexpected load. Another way of looking at it is systems with no hardbound SLA, meaning service level agreement. Also, you can say timeouts, which are not very time-bound systems, saying that given a request, it should be executed within X time. If it is hardbound, then that cannot be achieved with soft real-time. Where the impact of SLA breach is not life-threatening. I think it's better we try understanding which systems cannot be considered as soft real-time. Taking example of flight. I do not know every operation in flight is not eligible for Erlang or not, but at least in general sense, you can say that landing of a flight, even if there is a delay in execution of that command, that means a plane can crash, leading to death. So I believe Erlang cannot be used in that condition at least, where it's so time bound that if there is a delay, it's a major disaster. Another example could be a trading system where if there is a delay of any microsecond or millisecond, it is equivalent to huge loss, which is equivalent to huge debt, which is also equivalent to a near death situation. So even in this case, where it is so tightly bound, timing is required. This is not suitable for a soft real time. So Erlang is not right choice, I believe. Okay, why is this important? As I said, during unexpected load where traffic spikes, correct? Another reason is to tame greedy processes. Meaning, if there's any buggy code or a process which consumes lot of CPU, it cannot bring down the system. Because of the software real time, it makes sure that system will work well even when there is a process or something which is, you can say, consuming lot of CPU. For example, we can take RabbitMQ consumer consuming a faulty event. It gets into a loop. I will not be able to acknowledge it because it doesn't have relevant information. So it gets into a loop. Even this process, it is an infinite loop if you look at it. Even this process will not bring down the system, but there is little slowness in the system because of soft real time. I hope it makes sense. Okay, to understand further, let's try understanding how it works in Java. So if you have an application deployed in Tomcat, Tomcat being an application server, we need to consider three factors: max connection, accept count, and max threads. What is max connection? Max connection is number of maximum requests Tomcat can take in, basically. And accept count. Accept count is a OS level backlog queue size, basically. Let's understand what it means. If a system is taking in more than max connection requests, then those requests are piled up at the OS layer in a queue called backlog queue. That size is defined by accept count. Meaning, if a request comes more than max connection plus accept count, those requests will not be taken inside the system. Means systems will start rejecting those requests. Basically, you can say a total number of max connection plus accept count is the total number of connection a system can take. Max connection is total number of connection a Tomcat can take. Clear? Okay, coming to max thread. What is max thread? Max thread value is a value which defines how many threads, Java threads, you can use to serve all those requests. Defining, meaning that if you have set max thread as 100, meaning only 100 requests can be served simultaneously, concurrently, basically. So all the remaining requests will be piled up in an internal queue. So whenever a thread gets free, it takes up the next request and process, meaning only 100 will be in execution. Others will be in waiting state, you can say that. But in Erlang, max connection and accept count holds good. It's the same meaning even here, but there's no concept of max thread. Instead, Beam creates those many threads as many as number of cores. Meaning if we have two core system, that means there's a two threads created internally. And each request is created as a process, Erlang's process, correct? Now, if you have n number of process, all those, basically by meaning only two threads are created at Beam, doesn't mean only two requests will be concurrently handled. All the requests are concurrently handled just by using these two threads. How that happens, I'll explain further in the Beam, but this is how Erlang works. It will concurrently process all the requests using those two threads. Okay, this example, I think Indians can correlate to Pani Puri example. More than understanding the soft real time, this example will actually make you feel the soft real time. For people who do not know Pani Puri, it's in the nature how it is served, we can correlate it to soft real time. So let me try understanding how it is served. So considering a plate of Pani Puris, which has 6 puris basically. A pani puri guy takes one puri at a time, puts some ingredients into it and serves one at a time to a customer. This process will repeat until a customer gets 6 puris. This is how it is served, not per plate, I mean directly in a plate of 6 puris. Instead, it is served one by one. This is how pani puri is eaten. So if you correlate into this soft real time world, in regular days, okay, let's consider two different guys. One pani puri guy serves one customer at a time. Let's call him A. And another pani puri guy serves multiple customers at a time. Let's call him B. In regular days, if there is single customer each for both of them, then there is no difference how it is behaving. Both will serve one customer at a time. There is no difference. So it doesn't make sense. I mean, soft real-time system and others behave more or less same. But when there are lot of customers, A will still serve one customer at a time. Serve him 6 puris, then the next person will come. All the others will be lined up behind him waiting to eat pani puri. Got it? B being more efficient, I believe, I feel that he's more efficient. What he'll do is, he'll serve every customer by giving each puri one at a time in some fashion, maybe in a round robin fashion. Okay, at least if you see the behavior wise, here 5 people are at least getting something to eat. In the first guy, one guy is happy that he is getting everything, but rest all are little anxious that when will I get it type. Maybe that 5th customer even gets frustrated and leaves the queue. The second behavior is soft real-time behavior actually. If you consider this as a thread or single core process where B, representing a soft real-time system, a single thread or it's in Erlang terms it's scheduler, but let's say it as a thread. He will serve, those customers, if you think them as a process, he will give each puri one by one to a person. And that puri represents the time slot given to him to execute certain amount of work in that process. This is how Erlang actually behaves. He gives chunk by chunk time slice for execution of the process. Here, that is represented as each single pani puri given to each customer. But in Java-like application, if there is only single thread, that means if customers are considered as a user request, only one user request will be served and rest all will be waiting to execute. That's the difference between how things work. It makes sense? Okay. At least you could relate to? Okay. Understanding more or less that pani puri concept is within the, in simple terms, is within the beam. Okay, in beam, everything works as a process. And each request are a Erlang process, right? But there should be somebody who is managing those processes to run concurrently. That is done by scheduler. There will be one scheduler per core. If there are 2 core, that means 2 scheduler. And each scheduler will have a run queue where all the process which are ready to be run are kept in. Sorry. Okay. All the process which are ready to run are kept in the run queue. And now the scheduler's job is to efficiently schedule them so that it runs, concurrently, right? So what does the scheduler does it? It takes a process from the run queue, gives it certain amount of time to execute and puts it back to the queue and takes another one and puts it, does the execution and puts it back to the queue. This happens for all the process within the run queue. And that certain amount of time given for each process to process is called reductions in Erlang. Actually, it's not a time factor, rather in simple terms, it's considered as a number of function call it executes. It's actually in simple terms, it may be much more complex than what it is, But for everybody to understand, you can understand it as the number of function calls it executes. So by default, Erlang provides with 2,000 reduction per process, meaning that a process will run 2,000 function calls before it is preempted and put back to the queue. So this goes on for every process. So if you see, every process moves one step at a time. This is how you serve everybody in Erlang. Okay, and the migration logic written above that part is to make sure that run queue is optimally used, saying that if one run queue has a more process or a long running process, it makes to balance it out. That is how Erlang works. This is in simple terms. To explain this entirely, it is a session in itself. Scalable fault-tolerant distributed language. Whenever we hear the term scalable fault-tolerant distributed, we tend to understand with respect to systems, being scalable system, fault-tolerant system, distributed system. We achieve it by having fault tolerance by ELB, keeping two nodes, all that. But actually, this is the only language which supports scalability and fault tolerance as the language itself, because of the write concurrency model used by Erlang. So distribution is as simple as building a regular system, where all you need to do is cluster them. And clustering is as simple as running your node with the same, running all the nodes with same cookie, and running either one of the command. All will be clustered by itself. Best part is sending a message to a process in a local node and the remote node is same. The syntax, if you see, it's a PID, exclamatory mark, and the message. Only difference is a PID could be of a local or a remote. This is as simple as it is. I believe this is the only language which makes it that simple. Okay. This is the graph taken from last Thursday when there was a offer running where by booking the Redbus ticket, you could collect Rangoli stamp in Google Pay. I believe everybody, most of them at least, know what that means. Google had this concept of collecting 5 stamps to earn 251 rupees. So by booking the Redbus ticket, you could get a Rangoli stamp. So when this campaign was run, we had a sudden spike in the bookings. Even at the 4x spike in the bookings, our systems worked beautifully. There was no downtime. We could serve everybody with little delay. That is what a soft real time has benefited us with. The below system is actually one of our systems only, but not written in Erlang, where you could see huge numbers of timeout. It couldn't serve all those requests. That's the main difference we have seen in moving to Erlang. This is some of our strengths. Okay. This entire transaction platform is handled by 2+3 people, where three people are with little less experience. On an average, their experience is of 3 years. And in that, two are new to Erlang. It's been only 4 months that they are into Erlang with the background from Ruby and Java. So it's a mix and match of team. Even in this small team, we could handle, I mean, maybe that because of Erlang, it enables us to work better with the small team. Compared to Java, time to market in Erlang has improved 80%. This is the proven fact at Redbus, at least. Even in increase in transactions, we had not changed our infra. Infra could hold all kind of transaction spikes. Okay. When moving from Java to Erlang, we have reduced our infra from 12 cores to 4 cores with the same amount of traffic. The topmost layer is from the search engine taken. That it used to serve the same traffic with 100 plus cores in Java, and now it has been reduced to 32 cores. We had 2 major downtimes. We are live from 2 years and 2 months. So in that, even this year, we had no downtime. No more sleepless nights, thanks to self-healing capability of Erlang. We have not seen any issues so far, touch wood at least. Okay, these are few opinions from my colleagues. Okay, the first guy, he has started his career with Erlang. No background of any programming language. What he has to say is, easy and interesting to learn. It's the language for concurrent future. Okay. Right side, he has 2 years of experience in Java, 5 months in Erlang. What he has to say is, migration was difficult due to maddening syntax. However, it's an effort worthwhile. Concurrent and distributed. This C and D keeps me motivated. Good thing to hear, at least, I believe. Okay, moving from Ruby to Erlang was not difficult. Initially, I was stuck with the fact that you can't update a variable. See, these are the simplest, I mean, I can even say that it's the silliest problem anybody could face. But Erlang is awesome, but I miss loops. These are the comments what we hear at our workplace. Okay, what I would like to say is, learning Erlang from Java is not easy, but not because of Erlang's complexity, but because of the object-oriented mindset and not being able to push yourself out of your comfort zone. And for people who have not thought of using Erlang or not knowing, started understanding what Erlang is, you are missing out on huge benefits with Erlang or Erlang-like approach. Thank you. And these are some of the links which you can go through for more details of how we are doing using Erlang at Redbus.
Any questions?
It's nice presentation. So, how is the hiring experience like? Are you finding like
hiring experiences? As I said, people with different background are willing to learn Erlang. So it was not very challenging. Yes, finding a hardcore Erlang developer is little hard. But people willing to learn Erlang, that has helped us. Because even two joiners, which I mentioned in earlier comment, they were from different background. One was from Java, one was from Ruby. They are adapting very well with Erlang. So yes. And we could handle all this work with less small team compared to how we used to work with the Java. But answering your question, yes, finding a hardcore Erlang developer is a little hard.
Hi, I'm Pranav. Erlang also provides this feature called where you can hot code updates. Basically,
yes.
You can update the code without having to restart the entire system. So do you use that at Redbus?
No, we have not used it. But we have not used it. I know that it provides, but we have not used it.
OK, thank you.
Hi. Great talk. My question was like, you know, there is an observer kind of tool. So do you guys use to like debugging your system, or you have something else to do that?
Basically, you don't need observer to debug.
Like
basically,
the
you
remote so
sorry what?
So you can like get into the remote servers using right,
yes
from
yes
your
that I as I said that distribution thing right. You can cluster your system by starting your application with the same cookie. And then use that command to connect to each other. Then you can do, if you know the PID in that system, maybe from the log you could find it, and you can do whatever you need to do the remote debugging. It's that simple. We don't use observer as such, but observer we use to understand that supervision hierarchy. At least I have used it for that purpose. But debugging remote system, even in two of our instances we have done this, where locally we ran a node by setting the same cookie and connected to the remote server by giving that command and then running and finding, we tried even getting the process info to find if there is any problem with the process, memory or reductions, all that kind of information we have used it. Thank you.